What's up, poker people? This is Funchampion in the house, and we are back on our lesson today. That is day 24 of 66 days of hand reading. Let's get right back at it again. Sometimes just you have to prioritize things, and I thought it was important to complete. I mean, reaching out to my friend, rather than continuing the video to begin with. We'll put that behind and let's just dive into the learning part, since you would like to focus on this. Let's get started, guys.
Okay, awesome. So those are our
So today's video is actually against two villains, and we are going to also pull up Equilab. I'm going to rerun the Equilab tools, where we actually can narrow down our opponent's ranges in a much more detailed way, which is something similar to what Flopzilla does. Flopzilla is a paid program, and Equilab, as we are using it, is a free program. There's also a paid version for Equilab, which is called Power Equilab. But until we make, to the max utilization of available free resources, I don't think it makes sense to jump to the paid resources. So let's
three players,
do
myself,
that right away.
Stiznan and Rocka Bajan Tilt. Okay, interesting. Rocka Bajan Tilt, Stiznan, and Wacky One. So we'll put Rocka Bajan up here on this window, Stiznan down here, and we'll put myself down here. Now, I obviously, let's look at my simple, give myself one hand first. I am versus two limpers. I'm doing an isolation raise. So it's a hand that I like. It's not like I just have pocket threes and I want to see a flop and set mine. So I'm not going to give myself something that bad. I'm going to give myself something worth isolating one of these two loose passive. And I would love either one of these. This guy especially, look, is a 49-3. Love to play a pot, isolate him. He calls, he folds, and then great, we're heads up in position with a good hand. I'm just going to give myself some.
All right. So, the format that we have been following until now is to look at
he folds and the especially look, a four.
So the action is there's limp, there's over limp by another guy, which is very common at the stakes which we most of us play while learning, while starting out. Two limpers. So what Wacky One, that is Smart Poker Study guy, or Sky Matsuhashi, our professor for these 66 days, he does is isolation raises to 150 from 25. So it is essentially 4, 5, 6 times the limp, or we can also
fourth isolate and set my simple.
All right,
give myself one.
So this is what we see right now. The pot is 0.85, yeah, 0.85, and what Sky does is
hand
he raises
first.
It up.
I am versus two limpers. I'm
to 1.5. So probably he's following the standard formula of 3 into the last raise plus whatever money is in the pot. So 0.75 plus 0.85 is pretty much in this ballpark, which is what most people use for isolation raises. When they go with a certain formulation for those isolation raises.
I'm doing an isolation raise, so it's a hand.
What we are trying to do is we are trying to get heads up, as we understand from what Sky explained. I'll just repeat it so that we understand it in our own way. We are trying to isolate, as in we are trying to make everybody else fold who doesn't have a hand worth enough playing. Like if we limp a small blind, even though they have like probably 7-5 suited or something, like 7-10 off, they might just call that 0.15 to look at a cheap flop. This guy, in fact, the golfer guy, will get a free equity realization of 60% if we limp, and this guy also doesn't raise and he just has to check. So with any garbage hand, he could have 8 deuce off and still he would realize 60% of his equity. And on the rare occasions on which the flop comes deuce 8 or something crazy like that, we all are toast just because we limped. It could happen the other way as well. We could also have something like 9 deuce suited, and it goes all limp, 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 and the flop comes 9-9 deuce. But we are in a position to choose what we want to do with our 9 deuce. We are in a position to probably isolate, raise, bluff raise, and collect the pot even before it goes to the flop. Whereas if we just limp, we just offer golfer both of these situations. You know, they could easily fold, they could easily raise, they could easily check, and all of it would be, you know, really nice for them. So that's the difference. All right, and the intent right now is to isolate, as in to make everybody else fold. If like he has ace deuce off, he's obviously folding. He doesn't want to get into a big pot, probably multi-way with ace deuce off, so he would be folding. Similar situation with this guy. Now, as Kai said, we are trying to isolate versus this guy, who is an extremely loose and a passive player. So it would be nice to have, you know, even a decent hand, half decent hand in our entire range, like as we call it, the middle of our range, against this guy, and it would still be a decent one, a good one, a winner one. Also, this guy chooses to continue, which is a little bit strange, because he chooses very few hands to play, 17, and he doesn't raise any of those, which is concerning, which means that, you know, he just call with all of his hands, which could mean he's calling with ace king, he's calling with probably junk as well. All right, so let's continue.
And that I like. It's not like I just have pocket threes and I want to see a flop and set. I want to play a pot, isolate. I'm just going to give myself something very simple. Ace king suited. That's going to be my hand to start with. So we won't touch this again. I'm just going to stick with ace.
So right now the ranging is not for the hero. It is the intent is to range read the villains in this
ace
example.
King suited the entire time. But now let's see here. We get a couple folds, and now Rock of Asian Tilt in the small blind. You can see there's the button. The small blind decides to cold call, not really cold call because he has a small blind in, but basically to cold call a full six big blinds here. He's a 31-8 player, so we're putting Rock of Asian up here. What is he cold calling with in this instance? Super loose passive. I am not going to put 31-8. I'm not going to put like aces and kings or queens in his range. Maybe, no, actually, I'll put queens in his range. So let's give him, he's super loose passive. Let's give him a wide range, 33%. He's calling. I mean, the guy's so loose passive. Let's just say he's calling just about everything up top here in the Broadway.
So when Sky says that he's calling everything, what he essentially means is the 3-bet range is pretty, 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 pretty tight in their case. Since if they 3-bet, let's just put up Equilab over here. There's what's the position?
So he would 3-bet.
All right, their position is cutoff, hijack, low jack, and yeah. All right, that's their position. So if somebody just 3-bets, like 2% of the time, so just 1% of the times in like 200 hands, it's probably clear that, you know, they just 3-bet these combinations, because what else are they gonna 3-bet? I mean, this is also 1.5%, but a player who is gonna 3-bet only aces and kings is not gonna 3-bet tens, so it's fair enough to assume aces, kings, and queens. If they are really under 1% of 3-bets over 200, 200, 300 hands, or you have never seen them 3-bet, they just call, then these two hands may even be in their calling range, if that's the case. So, and especially when, you know, they have so many players behind and they don't do it in the middle position, in the, not even in the later position, probably only on the button or from the blind. So that is also a very critical piece of information, in my opinion. If we can get that, we can have some understanding of what range we can, you know, 3-bet them or call their 3-bets with. All right. So
players, so I'm not going to give him that three betting range. So we're going to put him on a very wide range.
Look at that.
Here for calling. Maybe not this low here. Definitely all those pocket pairs. Every ace. So we just don't know much about him. We'll give him every single ace. We'll give him every Broadway, not these offsuit crappy Broadways.
That's interesting. So we are building a calling range again, just like Sky did. Yeah. So all the suited aces, all the suited kings. Yeah, I mean, if they're limping, yeah, that's very much possible, in my opinion, as well. All the offsuit Broadways, all the suited Broadways. Got it. And some amount of suited connectors. And let's say all pairs for set mining purposes. 10-8 suited, why not? Just throw that in there. And
let's give him down to queen 8 jack.
Couple of suited
players
gappers.
Like to call 9-6 suited or 69 suited.
All right.
Now let's give him that. Okay, so this is his range. It's a pretty darn wide range at 446 combos right here.
Yeah.
So that's interesting. 33% calling range that we're going to give this guy. We just don't know enough about him, and it's very possible with his stats, his pre-flop stats right there, 31-8, that he's calling something like this.
Yeah.
And then Stiznin decides to call. So what is his limp calling range for Stiznin?
Interesting. So guys, probably in one of the videos, we are also going to build all of these ranges. ISO sizing, if very small, for two EP limpers, gives literally the prize for all players. True, absolutely true. But what would you use as a sizing then, Arjun? Because in this case, I feel they
same
pretty much...
What is this limp?
So in this case, we just talked about this, probably you just joined, but we talked about this as in if 25-25 is the limp, the formula, usually the formula that you would use for ISO raising is 3 times the last raise, that is 0.25, like 3 times 0.25, 0.75, and any additional money that there is in the pot, which was 0.85. At the time of raising, so 0.75 and 0.85, 150, so that's exactly what they did. And as you see, the limp is 0.25, it's not anything more. I agree that still gives a good price to call for the big blind, could be slightly more as well. And then if somebody else calls, like if the small blind calls, then it becomes much more of a prize or a good price to call for this guy, and for then this guy it's so much easier, and this guy's obviously not going anywhere, you know, while closing the action, like Olympus wet dream, I guess, closing the action into a multi-way pot and you know, getting to see the flop. so that's that. But what sizing would you choose? I'm curious to know, with a pot that is 0.85. People have two limpers, not exactly early position, but yeah, you can call them early position, middle position limpers, because we ourselves are in the hijack. It's a button cutoff hijack. So this is low jack, this is UTG plus two, if you want to label them like that. I feel the ISO raise was just right. It could be definitely be 1.7, 1.8. And they are all playing super deep stack as well. So unless our hero, our player, has a really good hand, ISO raising a super big might also, you know, not be the best idea. Because then if they call, there's already 30. No, there's not 37 in the pot. I think there's some miss. I'd go 10, 15 considering the player's tie. Hold on. I think there's some confusion. So Arjun, what happened is, this is, you're watching it right now, is it? Let me just pull it back. Okay, not this much. Okay. Yeah. So this is no wait. So this is the situation is zero. It's 10.25 cents game. Like this is a cash game. That's fine. Well, this would be so much better if it was in big blinds because we're so used to playing in big blinds. But anyway, the big blind is 0.25. 0.25 is limped by this guy. 0.25 is limped by this guy. So the pot, yep, 0.10.
We get a limper, a super.
Yeah. So right now, the pot is 0.85 because 0.25, 0.25, 0.25 is 0.75 and 0.1 is 0.85. No antes, obviously, cash game. So this is a 0.85 worth pot. How much would you be raising is the question in that case. Oh, 3.75? Did you mean 3.75? Okay, take your time. Type out without typos. Alright, so I think the raise that they did was just on the spot. It could be a little bit more because we want to be slightly, you know, aggressive in terms of making sure that the blinds are folding and we don't go too much multiway into the flop. So here, what raise size do you suggest? Alright, so let's pull up our notepad as well, because that's definitely, until you type out the answer, I am pulling up my notepad, which is showing up on screen. Poker study and hand reading, blah 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 blah. Let's go. Action items. Perfect. Perfect, perfect. D22. Well, we'll make a few notes which you like doing. My newest favorite hobby. Alright, day 24. Ask yourself the question, apart from mathematically, why are you ISOing? Alright. Facing two limpers, one is EP, second one is MP. All right, and we all 100 BB deep. Point 0.25, small blind is 0.10 and big blind is 0.25. All right, so 10 to 15 BB. All right, so you would go 2.5 to something like 3.3. That's what you mean. All right. So that means you would go 10x, you have to go 1.5, you would go 2.5-ish, so you would probably make it 3x of what is formulated. I'll ask myself the question, why am I ISOing? I'm ISOing from this position to make sure that I don't give a good price for any of these guys to call. And if this guy wants to continue, I'd like to get heads up with them. But we also know if they call, if we make a big raise, if they call, they are again getting the middle position is getting a good price to call. So it has to be a balance between, undersizing it, which will invite everybody into the pot, and oversizing it, which will mean if there's one caller, and God forbid if the call is here, then everybody else gets great price to call. Because then they are like, they need 28-25% equity-ish to actually justify the call preflop as plus EV. All right, so let's still continue. I have noted down the also I'm 200 BB deep, so I will go larger in the sizing. Yeah, that makes sense. That absolutely makes sense. Size. What do we want to achieve with that raise sizing? This is also to showcase my beautiful handwriting, among other things. All right, just kidding, guys.
For okay. Loose passive, another limper.
But that's a very, very, you know, very, very critical and very basic question that we often miss in terms of thinking. What am I going to size my raise? Even three bets. I mean, it just need not be this ISO. Even three bets. What are we going to achieve with the sizing? Sometimes you make it 3x. Sometimes you make it 3.5x. Sometimes we are out of position. We can make it a bit larger. Are we trying to get a fold from everybody? Are we trying to get a call? And are we happy to play post-flop? Is that it? Because that is also another thing that we see and do quite often in the tournaments. That is, if we have aces or kings or whatever, ace-king, probably 3-bet on the slightly lower side when it's you know, later stages and we have like 30-ish bigs and stuff. And that often also sounds alarm bells for the opponent. But also, if they think that they do have a decent hand, they definitely call and continue. And then it's our c-bet that's most often gonna get a fold. Or we stand to stack them off if they hit something good. So the intent in that case, when 3-betting small, is to actually get our opponent to call to extract more value. And pre-flop, since we believe we are ahead of them, we want to get more money in the pot while we are ahead. So that's the intent of getting more money into the pot. But at the same time, we don't want to size it so much that it definitely gets a fold from the opponent. That's in tournaments. But here, this also could be a tournament pre-ante, first 10-20 hands of the tournament, and still we are so deep with ace king suited or with kings. Do we want to size it up, or do we want to keep the price low? And what is our intention in making those sizings? A very, very interesting point, and I have made note of it. Let's bring it up sometime later.
Right here, 5-6 currently versus those initial limpy hands, especially a lot of that suited stuff that he can limp in with initially, can call here because he closes the action. I could see 8-7 off limping in, 7-6 off possibly limping and then fold, or possibly limping and then calling. 6-5 off probably wouldn't limp in the first place. All these offsuit broadways, offsuit aces, suited aces. Yeah, I think this is pretty good. So he has a slightly wider range at 474 combos, 35%. Now, if we are isolating with a nice hand like ace king suited. Oh, let's stop this. So it was running a Monte Carlo simulation. Currently, versus these two very similar ranges, we have 48% equity. Things are lovely right now, pre-flop, before the flop comes, versus these two players. And we have ultimate position buttons here, so we are against a small blind and an MP player. Here we are in the hijack, so things are looking great for us to win some money on this pot, or in this pot.
Nice.
Ace, 9-10, spade, club. Great. So on that board currently, if these ranges are accurate, I'm sure it's run a few million hands already, I can hit stop. We have 64% equity because, of course, we have that top pair. We are behind a couple of sets that our opponents could have, set of 10, set of 9s, 2 ace. Pair, 10, 9, ace, 10, ace, 9, 2 pairs as well. But currently, I mean, things are looking pretty. We're basically going to be betting for value, I believe, on this pot right, or on this flop right here. We get a check. We get a check. And we check as well. Okay, so I do not have ace-king. I probably have, I don't know, pocket eights or sevens now for making this kind of check behind. I think I should bet as well, even if I had like kings or queens right here, even though it's an ace-high board, we can see looking at their ranges, they have tons of non-ace hands. Most of their hands are non-aces. This guy as well, right? So I should be betting with kings, queens, well, any...
Are they really, though? A lot of non-ace hands? Because all ace-x combos are there in the range. Every single ace-x combo, suited and off-suited. Let's find out. Let's find out. So this is where we are, you know, utilizing our Equilab tool to the max. We ignore this little useful icon usually. So we go into that. And it opens up an amazing, amazing window that I'm not sure you guys have seen all the time, but yeah, this is the amazing window in Equilab, in my opinion. So what we do here is essentially we can look at loads of hands combos in our range. So this yellow is already the highlighted range in the range that we have selected. If you want to see it, so you see this is the range that we have selected. And if we want to go ahead and take a look at it like this, so I hope it's making sense. These are four because they are suited combos, and you can see that they exist on the right side of this grid because right side is the suited side, and left side, triangle, mad angle, whatever, is the offsuit side. And these middle ones are the pocket pairs, which are six in number exactly. Let me know if there's one or two less or more. All right, so top pair, there we go. How many ace x hands do we have? It's very easy to calculate. Now we were doing a slightly more manual method early on, but a little bit of study help me see this, you know, hidden door, secret door in Equilab, which like pulls up so much of, you know, so much of juicy stuff. And all right, one pair, top pair. And if we just remove that and one pair and second pocket pair. So how many kings or queens or jacks do we have in our range is quite here. All right, let's just stick to this. One pair, top pair, so about 120 combos. Count is also given. We don't have to do much. You just have to look at these numbers and be amazed. 33%. So that's the frequency with which we'll have ace x's. Seems like villains ace x combos are suited. Ace queen, ace jack could be offsuit. Absolutely. Absolutely. But here as well, we have included, like, yeah, we should exclude ace king at least from the three betting range. But you can see here in villain 2, let's call him villain 2, second one. Villain 2's range is top pair. Yeah, it has, the frequency is just slightly more, although the combos are less, the frequency is more, which means they are playing tighter range. And out of those, 117 combos are quite a lot, if that makes sense.
Pocket pair. I should be betting here just to rep that ace, just to try to get these guys off of their hands, because it's a straight bluff. You know, I want all the flush draws to fold. I want straight draws to fold. Not that they are folding, but I think I need to rep that ace. And if they hit absolutely
honestly, no flush draw is folding, right? I mean, let's be very realistic. We size our bet four into this pot of five. Is a flush draw folding? I don't think so. They definitely have a lot of implied odds. They do have shit ton of equity if they actually have any sort of ASX of clubs in their hand. They are definitely loving their life and they're not folding.
Nothing.
Straight draw probably might fold to a huge bet. But then again, I don't think a draw is folding. Gut shot might fold. A proper draw, which is flopped, like king, queen of clubs or something like that, is never folding.
On this board, then my pocket queens can take down a pot right here. Let's say he had like, 5-6 of hearts. And then he had a queen 3 suited of hearts as well, whatever. They're both going to be folding on this board, and I can take it down with my pocket 8s or my pocket queens or kings here. Yeah, so I think it's a good board to bet. But I do decide to check. Now, let's see. First off, even though the action was checking, let's see here. Is there anything that he is automatically betting instead of checking? What was the name of this guy? Rockabasian Tilt. Okay, so flops a set. He can definitely check with the intent to check raise. Two pair can.
King. All right. Let's go through the process and we'll see how we are narrowing down.
Check. Top pair can check. Pocket pair check in. Mid pair check in. Weak pairs. What are they? Oh, those are all totally checking. I mean, some of them pair plus a backdoor draw. Totally checking. They don't. Nothing out of this guy's range, I think, is forced to bet here. Nothing could be forced to donk lead. It's just good to think about it here. So I think all of these 100% of
that begs the question, what is forced to donk lead? In what situations is a donk lead forced? Or I don't think a donk lead or donk bet can be quite balanced then. I mean, you would do it with good hands, decent hands, but are you doing it with air in a three-way pot? I don't think so.
Of his preflop range is checking here. Some of it is check raising sets and two pairs, possibly top pair if he really likes an ace king or an ace queen.
Check raise, but, though, you know, I understand.
He's absolutely capable of 100% of his preflop range of checking and calling or checking and raising here. But he's definitely checking. Now this guy as well, I think the same thing holds true. All of his hands can check here. Even though one player already checked and showed passivity, even if he has a set of nines or tens, he could check here, hoping that I'm going to c-bet. So if I c-bet, he calls, he can call or even check raise to get value out of two players that are already in the pot right here. So it's totally conceivable that he is checking 100% of his range. Now, I do not think it's conceivable that I'm checking an ace-king suited here. I think I'm betting 100% of the time with ace-king, but I've already chosen that as my preflop holding, so if I take that away, now that would change the cards that these guys are capable of having here. And I just chose ace-king suited. Okay, cool. Yep, good. So currently, on this, still running a Monte Carlo, on this flop right here, with all of us checking, and being that ace king, I have 64% equity, but that's probably not accurate anymore. All right, so let's see here. Ace of clubs, what a lovely one. A min bet. So look at that, 25 cents into the $5 right here.
Okay, so this is another common occurrence, not just at the beginning stakes, but also at the stakes, the low to mid range stakes, we can say about 800 buy-ins and 500-600 buy-ins, up to 1,000 buy-ins also, and also beyond that, I've seen as we get. But this is not a early game behavior. This is much more close to what happens in the end game, stage where a multi-way pot and somebody bets min. Likely, it is always, almost always polarized. So it could be that, they're just betting something, like if somebody has clipped and like if somebody has a flush draw, if they have the nuts, they're doing it so that if somebody has a flush completed on the turn, they'll charge it and they'll just call it off and show their ace 10 or ace 9 or whatever, or nines, whatever. Or else they are just doing it with, ace and ace deuce off, something like that, which does not hit this board at all in any other way apart from trips, to see if somebody actually has completed the flush or somebody likes the hand so much that they are actually gonna bet or raise there. So this is often, is this what they call a probe bet? Because I haven't studied until the turn yet, but this seems like a bet which is just poking a little bit. Like, if you have a better hand, why don't you raise me? If you don't have anything, then just fold, because I might have the best hand. Something on those lines.
It's probably not going for any...
I read it on these lines. Could be wrong.
Any kind of value. It's probably just a really weak bluff and a call and a call. Wow, that's interesting. So I guarantee I do not have a full house here. I don't have a set of nines or a set of tens for a full house. I don't have a random ace for trips. I would be raising for value. Look at the stacks on these players. I would definitely want to be building the pot. I probably just have some random club draw right here, is my guess, wanting to keep it small. So that, now, what is he donk leading here? Now, this guy's super loose passive. He could just be donk leading and hoping that he or I throw in a $4 raise. So he could be donk leading his sets. All of this stuff could be donk leading. Busted. Oops, I didn't put the card in. Did I? No, I didn't. He could be leading with all of his hands and everything, hoping for a raise. If he has quad aces here, if he has pocket tens for a second nut full house, I mean, he should be betting more for value if he does have a value hand. But it's possible, I don't know much about this player, it's possible he's making this bet trying to get somebody to bluff raise him. So I've really got to keep every hand in his range right here. We all showed passivity preflop, so he could be just making a min bet trying to steal the pot with all of his bluffs. And then he could be betting with his really good hands right here. Now, this guy, we can definitely limit his range. He's calling this tiny bet on this board. He does not have any kind of nut hands whatsoever. So he's keeping his range big by making that bet.
All right. I've also seen this behavior when people have the nuts. Again, probably our player pool tendencies are a lot more trappy in these situations. Like, as soon as I, you know, raise... Not all in, I just raise. This is usually the situation when we are like all 30, 40 bigs, all right? And there are like 7, 8 bigs in the middle, and somebody bets one big blind, they just call, and we raise it to like 4 or 4.5 or something like that, like half pot or 60% pot or of that sort. Then one guy folds and the one guy who flatted jams. So that is also... this call can also be as deceiving as this guy's, but more often than not, they don't have much. But yeah, once or twice, once in a while, they are going to show up with, you know, a jam, limp jam on the turn when raised.
He's going to narrow his range by making that call. So, no quads. He does not have a full house he would be raising. No flush, he'd be raising. I really believe his flushes would be raising here on the third flush card. I mean, there's no point in thinking that somebody has him beat with a full house. So those are raising straights. Three of a kinds, I really think three of a kinds are raising too. I don't see them just calling and what, hoping that I raise? No, I don't think so. Middle pairs can be calling here on this scary board. Weak pairs can be calling. I generally don't click no made hand because a lot of those are built in with other stuff too. Nut flushes, second, third, all of these different draws could be calling because it is just a quarter to hit. And then, you know, if he does hit a draw, but it's a fourth club and he had the gut shot straight draw, he can fold the river. So yeah, I'm going to say that, wow, look at that.
So essentially, middle, weak pair, so marginals, junk, and crazy good draws. So pretty polarized, probably, in my opinion.
And a third weak flush. No. Oh, whoops, because I have no flush draw. I shouldn't be clicking that. Open ender, gut shot, weak flush. Okay, so now with all of his draws and the middle and weak pairs, he has 62% of his flop range is making this call right here because he would be raising with the nut stuff. So he obviously capped his range by just calling on this super wet board, because if he had a value hand... $5 and it's $18 behind, he's gonna raise. And then me too, with just my call, I don't have ace king. I have pocket jacks with a jack of clubs, that kind of a thing, or pocket queens with a queen of clubs here to make this call. I don't have a hand that I think I can raise for value. So I don't have trips or better in this instance, guaranteed. So as it stands with that flop range, I'm sorry, with the turn ranges selected here, we have If we do soft, if we have trips now on that, we'd have 72% equity. Most likely, we have something like take off the ace king. Let's put on the queens. If we have something like the queens, yeah, I'll go ahead and make the change. If we have something like the queens, we actually have now 50% equity versus these two players. This guy, this guy kept his range really wide by making that call. He narrowed his range big time, just weaker stuff and draw, so his equity is super low. But us, we have second pair right now, or you can think of it as two pair, I guess, pocket aces and queens. Not pocket aces, aces and queens, two pair. So we have 50% equity. Plus, we have a few queen of clubs in our range, too, for the second nut flush draw on this paired board. So we'll just keep it for queens for myself. Let's see what happens on this river.
Yikes.
Nelly. A third ace. How lovely is that? Now the guy just min bets again? And now we have a raise. Oh, all man. Right, he could be throwing me for a loop, and he actually had a third ace. And I decide to call, too. Wow. So I think I have aces full of queens. Makes total sense to me. And he has aces full of tens or something, you know, to make that bet right there. And another call. So he decided to – he min bet. So let's go back to that. Min bet here.
So OP on this.
On the ace of hearts. Good. I don't think – I mean, if he wants value, he doesn't have quads. He doesn't have a full house. He's definitely going to be betting for more than just a min bet.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. Just got up a fair bit late. Just did some stuff. Oh, remove equilab. I'm so sad. So sad. So sorry.
Pocket pair.
Let me just rerun. Yes, I flopped. I'll just reach out to you after this session.
Full sense to me. And he has aces full of tens or something, you know, to make that bet right there. Look, he could be the guy just min bets again. And now we have a raise. Oh, man, yeah. he could be throwing me for a loop, and he actually had a third ace. And I decide to call, too. Wow, so I think I have aces full of queens. Makes total sense to me. And he has aces full of tens or something, you know, to make that bet right there. And another call. So he decided to – he min bet. So let's go back to that. Min bet here on the ace of hearts. Good. I don't think – I mean, if he wants value, he doesn't have quads, he doesn't have a full house, he's definitely going to be betting for more than just a min bet. Pocket pair below top pair. Those queens and jacks give him a full house. Ace is full. Those could be making that bet. Mid pairs, all those tens could be betting. Weak pairs could be betting as well. Because you could see overall, this guy is super freaking, super freaking passive. It makes sense that he's betting and calling with all the full houses that are just weaker than quad aces. You know, so even if he had tens full, he's now just going to min bet and then call with aces full of tens. Tens full on the flop or on the turn is what I meant to say. Flushes could be min bet calling, and that's it. Yeah, so we've actually finally done some narrowing of this guy's range based on his play right there. Tiny little min bet. Because he's only min betting basically with some kind of a made hand. Right there. I mean, he could be bluffing again on that ace, but he's got to throw out a bigger bet to make it more plausible, I would say. Now, this guy, coming with a tiny little 4x raise, it could be quads that he's doing that with. A full house as well, just trying to get value, maybe thinking I'm not going to call anything but just a dollar on that scary board. Mid pairs, he could be making that raise with as well.
Wow,
weak pairs, what were those? Yeah, all those random 8s and 9s. Well, we don't want to say... I think we can remove some of these weak pairs from his range for sure. I don't see why he would be raising with this stuff, unless it's a weak bluff with a showdown kind of hand. It just feels super, like a super bad bluff to me. Like you're not going to, making that dollar feels like you want a call. So I'm not even.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely nobody's folding, especially if they are closing action, the last guys, the guy who bet first, the small blind, isn't folding. We are also pretty much priced in with that $1. So seems like an insanely thin value bet.
I'm not even going to put these under pair of nines.
Because nobody is honestly folding to that $1.
Actually, no. Let's not put any of these in. Let's cancel.
Except for super
none of these nines. These mid pairs with tens could do it. Because he beats all the aces full of nine hands. And he beats anything if anybody has a lower pocket pair. He beats with his 10 right now. So we're going to say he has that. He's not doing with flushes, So we've actually narrowed him down again quite a bit from 447 hands preflop to 125. This guy had a 400 and something as well, down to 140 right now. So that's great. So if we do have the pocket queens, we have aces full of queens. Right now, we have 92% equity in this hand versus these two ranges. Now, because I don't know how they play, I'm not going to say that pocket queens is an automatic raise here. Mm. Because just how passive these guys are, I think we have, you know, 80% of the time we have the best hand. But it's very possible that this guy has been slow playing an ace the whole way, finally hit quads and decided to make a small bet because nothing else would pay him off. Right. It is possible. So just because we have the third nut hand, the nuts, like the total nuts would be any ace, right? For quads. The second nuts would be pocket kings for ace full of queens. And if we had queens, I'm sorry, aces full of kings would be second best. And if we had queens, we'd have aces full of queens here. Jacks would be the fourth best hand, aces full of jacks.
Yeah.
So, you know, without the super nuts right here on...
But we also have to understand them over-limping, a limp from this guy could very well mean lot of ace-x, even ace-x offsuit hands, and this small blind simply got super... They just thought they got a decent price to just, you know, call and just see the flop. Probably also could easily be an ace-x that they decided to continue ace-x suited. Small ace-x, ace-3, ace-4 suited kind of hand. So a lot of ace-x's do exist. Although queens do seem like the third or fourth, third best hand. Kings seem like the second best hand. In terms of frequency or in terms of the total number of combos, ace x is way ahead in terms of the second best hand. So there'll be so many, so much percentage of top hands at ace x hands in either of these ranges. Although three aces on the board does mean that ace x with any one of us is super less likely, but it is there in both of these ranges and in plenty.
On such a scary board, somebody's finally raising, just a call is in order. You don't have to raise. I don't think we'd want to make it $2 or $3 or even $5 to try to get value out of a random 10 right here.
Right.
And a call. Great. So let's see what they have. Pocket nines.
Only one suited ace combo though. Only one suited ace. Oh yeah, yeah. True. Suited ace combos is only one. But then also, as you see, the assignment is such that since there are limps, they could be any ace x. So yeah, good point over there. Since we have removed another ace on the river, there's going to be very few combos to begin with. But still, there are plenty of combos, is what I meant. Like for kings and queens, if we have queens and if you're afraid of kings, that's like a non-existent fear. But if you have kings and you're afraid of any ace-x, that's a pretty real fear to have, in my opinion.
We removed sets from his range because this was on the flop and we said that he would have...
Nobody has this. Is now we know. If they have...
No, on the turn. That's right. Because...
Get this, if they have, it's race three, right? Somebody, John Abraham has aces, and then Saif Ali also has aces. So, and there's an ace on the board as well.
Why would he just call with...
Fuck all movie reference. Apologies for that.
A set of nines. I guess, sure, it's a scary third club, but yeah, I guess I should have kept the nines in his range because it is such a scary turn card. Okay, interesting. Now we have, kings. Oh, without the king of clubs. Okay, so it makes sense the way I played it right there. We do have the aces full of kings. The second nut hand, quad aces was the nuts here. And then, whoops. And this last player, pocket sixes.
Okay.
Makes sense. Those are still in his range the whole way. That he would play it the way he did, min betting on the turn with absolutely nothing, just trying to bluff. And then min bet making a blocking bet on the river, hoping that his aces full of sixes has enough showdown value. And it makes sense. I don't think he should have called. I think he just wasted his money when he raised and I called. Guaranteed, I'm not calling with a worse full house than sixes. I'm not calling with fives right here. And right. This guy is not raising with fives or fours. Like five so or four. He should have, his bet was fine. And then once he gets raised, just fold right there.
Epic.
I wouldn't have called.
Wow. So this is another huge, huge, huge point in my opinion. Now, I forget everything about who has many aces and less kings and stuff like that. But this is so important as a takeaway in my opinion, because once you bet something into a pot, somebody raises and somebody else calls, it is very likely we are beat, and it does not make sense to make that call unless you are in a bluff heavy field. I've been on this side plenty of times. Like, we raise, we make a like 20-30% river bet, we get raised and probably sometimes even re-raised or raised, and we think we have a good hand, or at least second or third nuts, and we end up calling and seeing somebody has you know, the first nuts and somebody else comparable to us or even lesser. So essentially what it means is we pay a small flop price, we play a medium-sized turn price to see the river, and on the river the bet sizing or the price that we pay to see a showdown, the price that we see to see a showdown is significantly comparable to the money that we have put in the pot until now. Although I do understand that it is not prudent to think of like, you know, how much we already have put in the pot versus how much do we put now, but it does make sense because that's how we build the pot and how we go from SPR whatever 9-10 to SPR 1 as a matter of just, you know, check raising. I'm getting a good price, I should just call. I feel all these discussions are connected and they should be connected so that any errors can be easily pointed out. Otherwise, on the river, if somebody bets 30% and somebody calls, we are priced into call because we don't need to be right, you know, more than whatever, for 3 or 4 out of 10 times. But that's not the case because we know that, you know, we are more or less beat with sixes in this case. So it's prudent to fold and even save money, or save our chips, or save our blinds. When it's pretty clear that we are beat, and not just go by we are priced in kind of a thought process. At least that's what I think in most situations, especially when we are going at the stab, we are going at a, you know, a little bit brave bet to take the pot down, or a brave block bet, and then we get raised and you're like, ah, you just have to make a crying fold. But that's probably not the best of the approaches. All right, had the guy ISO'd on turn, kings would have folded. Turn. Right. Probably, yeah, because they don't have a club. Is that what you're trying to hint? The nines guy? Yeah, I see what you're saying. If the nines guy, yeah, if the nines guy would have like raised big on the turn, yeah, he would have taken down the pot pretty much. Probably just wanted, you know, extract max value, or was just I don't know what nines was thinking. They slow played, right? That's what they did.
All that. And yeah, and so I think my mistake in the hand, kings make sense for the way I played it the whole way on an ace high flop. Although I would prefer a flop C bet next time on an ace high flop. Rep the ace versus these two guys. I think is what I should have done, without a doubt. And then this guy right here, I guess I should have kept in his set of nines, even on without raising. Dang it, no. I mean, man, he played it so passively. Most players, hey, Rob.
Now, Sky is catching up to what Arjun already put in the chat a few minutes ago. So, on 9-9-8 queen board, I folded tens to small blind pot size river bet. After BB called, both of them had Jack Deuce off. I'm not even kidding. Oh boy, you don't need to be kidding, I believe you. But again, Piyush, although this time you saw yourself fold the best hand, that is not going to be the case most of the time. I mean, like I said, if we are in a bluff heavy field, if we have seen them make pot size riverbeds with air in any of the showdowns, that needs to be put on the note, in my opinion, so that we are aware in terms of, you know, if they do that, we can take a call next time. Because once you have paid them, you know, with your fold, next time you can pay them with a call. But they deserve that call then. If they are bluffing, if they have shown the bluff, then it means, you know, can decide our MDF and just make a call. Nines slept in the middle of the hand and woke up on the river.
Abgag, how's it going? Thanks for joining.
Hello, Leo City, just joining in
most
at the end of today's session, but never mind, you can always watch it.
Players would have raised as soon as they turned that full house, even though it was the underfull. Why would you be scared? Nobody bet the flop, so nobody likely has an ace. Why would you be scared that somebody could have tens full or aces full of tens or something like that? He should have raised. He got very little value out of this hand. He could have got more value from both of us by raising on the turn. At least a small raise right there. Yep. Alrighty. Well, thank you very much, everybody, for joining on this dual villain hand reading practice right here. It was unsuccessful because we removed the pocket nines from his range, but we had the pocket sixes for this guy in still. So that was a pretty interesting thing. I'll probably do something like this again, but maybe...
All right. Thank you so much, Sky, for day 24. Let's make sure with those likes and stuff to show our appreciation, guys. Like. All right. And the link is in the description of this video. If you would like to go and follow on your own, you would like to check out any particular hands or see how he reads and how we read and draw your own conclusions. So that would be nice. I encourage all of you to do that. Follow along with Equilab. And yeah, probably we'll do a small video series of, you know, the hidden pages on Equilab. So there are quite a lot of hidden pages on Equilab. There's an equity trainer in Equilab. Did you guys know that? Let me just pull it up. Let us see if we can have a quick equity training. Not entirely relevant with this, but still, let's do it. Yeah. In tools, we have equity trainer. Oh, guys, don't see it. Damn it. Give me a sec. What about this? Okay, let me see if I can put it on. Where's that? The equity trainer. All right. Oh, shoot. Where is that? Okay. Damn, what's happening? Equilab. Okay, here it is. All right, so predefined, let's go big blind versus button open raise, and we can have user defined ranges and all the goodness. All right, let's just go standard and start training. Ha, here we go. What do you know? You have this free in your Equilab. I mean, why is this not known by many people? All right, so let's just do this. Hero is king nine, villain's range is button. We are in the big blind and we are defending. We have already defended king nine off, and we hit 9-9 deuce. We have hit our trips. We are also redrawing to the flush, second nut flush draw. I'd say we are about 75 ish favorite, if not more or less. Let's see. Oh, 94% favorite. Damn, trips are difficult to defeat, especially versus button with the nines. That's strange. We can click next question. Go to, again, we have 9-10 suited of hearts, no heart on the board. Villain's range predefined. Yes, predefined, but you can always define it yourself. That's the best part. So we can probably go back here. You can user define villain's range. Let's say villain is an absolute tight player. who only has this range from the button, which is very, very less likely. All right, let's say this is villain's range. You can still start training with that. And we have ace 4 in the big blind, and we're defending against a tight range, remember. And 6-3-3 paired board, very less likely to hit our villain's range, in which case we have some, they could have spades, but I feel the equities are pretty much 50-50. We also have gut shots, pretty close, they have 43. Next question, we have ace 4 suited, and the board is 8-3 deuce, 2 diamonds. We don't have a diamond, there's no club on the board. We have a gut shot straight draw, 1 over, probably 4 outs, and 4-4 is 16, 32, something on these lines, in my opinion, 56-ish, yep, 43. Alright, so this is the point I'm trying to make, so you can have final results in terms of, how you did in your equity training. I mean, this is just amazing, isn't it? If all of this is available for free and you're not making use of it, that's bad. Anyway, we'll share some inputs from the Equilab study for you guys on another video, if that makes sense. And we'll continue this series tomorrow. Thank you so much for joining for day 24. Tomorrow will be day 25. Have a nice day. Smash those tables. Thank you.